Kyle, why don't we start with you down there?
Okay. I have a weird job. I don't know what I do. My official title is Tours and Rec Ambassador. So at Boulevard, when I wanted to come on full time, there was an opening for me because we had just bought a 4-story brick building that was built. I worked there doing tours for a couple years, and I was a teacher before I worked at Boulevard, and I really wanted to be on full time. This is a real story. I told my boss I was either going to commit suicide or come work at Boulevard full time. And her answer was, can you give me 5 days? Which I found to be a very weird answer to that proposition. 5 days later, though, we actually did have a press release saying we bought that building. So my department was going to go from about 16 to 75. So we were going to need people that were going to, I created the menu for the new beer hall. I helped hire and train a lot of that staff. But I came on about a year and a half before that happened. So in that interim, I got to become a certified Cicerone. The company paid for that, which is essentially, if you know what a sommelier is for wine, it's kind of the same for beer. It's like a 5-hour test. It's a little ridiculous. But then that made me in a position where I could go, when I'm hiring and training people, really be able to talk to them. I do have a master's degree in education, too. So I'm very highly qualified to talk about beer with people that we hired to bartend. So that kind of has put me in a neat position. I'm very passionate about food. My wife and I wrote a column called Cooking with Booze for about 4 years that was on a website called Made Man, which is kind of like a GQ-ish kind of website. So I did that while I was teaching, and I was a tour guide at Boulevard. So I have a very nebulous position. I did a beer dinner on Sunday night for the sales team. I went out to Powell Gardens. There's a guy named John Smith in Kansas City. He cooked a 5-course dinner. I paired him with beers and talked to people about why the beers were delicious and why they should love them about as much as I do. I had a meeting yesterday talking about a new barbecue sauce line that we're going to have in our gift shop. So I met with people and had a very serious, I'm not kidding, 30-minute talk about what beers and what ingredients we want in a barbecue sauce and what we're going to sell in the gift shop. So my day-to-day is actually really varied, which I think is probably not unique for a lot of people that work at breweries. There's kind of a small team of people that does a lot of things. So I wear a lot of different hats and just kind of get to wake up every day and see what needs to get done at the brewery.
Is that an okay answer?
Yeah,
Victoria. I think it's as direct as I can get it.
I'm going to use the microphone. I don't have as big of a voice. I'm Victoria. I work at 23rd Street Brewery here in town, and I'm an assistant brewer. I started brewing at 23rd Street in February. So about 90% of what I do is clean. I clean tanks. You know, it's like, we always joke that like with brewing, it's literally like 90% cleaning and then 10% brewing, you know? And so today I transferred a beer from a fermentation tank to serving and gotta clean both of those tanks. It's a lot of cleaning, but it is a lot of fun. I never am sad to go to work. You know, I wake up every morning and genuinely enjoy going to work. I graduated from KU last May with a chemistry degree, so I'm also kind of starting to do some lab work at 23rd Street Brewery, so for the quality assurance, quality control, so looking at the yeast and looking at water chemistry and all kinds of different things like that. So I'm starting to do a little bit of that, trying to study up on beer chemistry. I have my background in chemistry, but there's a lot to learn about the beer and chemistry. So, yeah, that's basically what I do.
Matt?
I'm Matt. I don't know if this is going to help. One of the co-founders of Lawrence Beer Company is getting ready to open up in the next few days for good this time. in East Lawrence, like 9th of Pennsylvania, right next to Bon Bon. I kind of touch all aspects of the business. I file a business plan and started getting the team together and back in 2015. And so I basically know enough to be dangerous about everything, sales and marketing, to brewing, to insurance. Maybe wants to talk about business insurance. You know, payroll and accounting and kind of community interaction. And my job is to kind of help shape the culture and direction of the company and also get the awesome staff to kind of release onto the world. There's no way that myself and our founders can do everything. So we have to, I guess, our main goal right now is to find good people who we can put in place and use their talents and just let them do it. My background, I managed bars and restaurants in college, geography, Latin American studies degree, KU. Super helpful. managed bars and restaurants in college. Went to work for a beer distributor. And then for the last about 6 years, I've been doing marketing and branding and merchandise for breweries around the country. Just managing like large swaths of the country and helping consult, design, merchandise, and marketing programs for some of the awesome breweries around. Now, took a plunge and we're doing it ourselves.
Brad?
I'm Brad Scott. I'm the Director of Operations and Logistics for Free State Brewing Company's production facility. It's different than the pub. It's where we brew for kegs and bottles out there in the market, and we're in three states. As the Director of Operations and Production, I pretty much oversee the whole building. I schedule almost every truck inbound with grain, hops, glass, labels, cardboard, carriers, chemicals. Some of this I've tried to take off my plate a little bit because it's getting pretty full. I do the full brew schedule. I'm constantly looking at inventory supplies at Standard Beverage to make sure I don't run out of something, but I got to be 2 weeks ahead of that for brewing. You can't just break out a beer in 2 days. It takes about 2 weeks at minimum. So I'm really looking at markets and looking at futures to make sure I don't run a certain bar out or a certain liquor store out of any of our product. Very challenging for me to keep all of that going and keep our yeast strains going with different pilsners and lagers. I work closely with the brew staff down at the pub too, because we share yeast. I do supply them with specific beers. I started out as a brewer in 1999 down at the pub. Degree in geology from KU, so useful. it is a science degree though, and so brewing is, I think, a science brain behind the initial part of it is very good to have, just because what you're doing, you're going to deal a lot with the water qualities. You have to know math. If you don't know math, it's almost impossible to do what we do. I think that goes across the board, lots of jobs out there. But yeah, I mean, I started off cleaning tanks, floors, trenches, hoses. You know, I used to say it was kind of glorified janitorial back in the day at that position. Because yeah, you scrub, 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 but if you have dirty tanks, our goal, we're in the business of making good beer and getting it out to you guys. So that's where we clean upon. But my position at this point is I'm kind of behind the scenes. I was on the bottling line all today because I'm filling in for some staff, so I've done it all. I've set up both bottling lines for Free State. I had no idea what I was doing there. The first line just showed up on a truck and we started to put together had Japanese instructions with Italian titles. Came from an Italian company made for a Japanese brewery. So we didn't know what anything was. We figured that out and struggled through it. Done our second line now, and trying to keep these guys supplied as much. And they're our business partner out and our distributor. So we work together and keeping the product out there and trying to keep it right. What I do, lots of Excel.
Trent.
All right, my name is Trent Glass. I am the Vice President of Operations for Standard Beverage Corporation. A lot of you probably might not recognize that name, as you might recognize some of the names that they spoke about prior. Standard Beverage is the largest distributor of premium wine, spirits, and beer in the state of Kansas. We distribute throughout the entire state of Kansas. We employ about 300 people, and I've been with Standard Beverage for 12 years now. A little bit about how I got involved in the business, like Matt talked about, trying to put my way through college. I was a bartender, barback, started off as a barback, worked my way up to a bartender, worked my way up to a bar manager, and then eventually became a partner and owner of two different bars here in town. And after about 10 years of doing that, then I got an opportunity to go work for Standard Beverage as a sales rep here in town, and my job was to call on restaurants and bars here in town, which, since I was in the bar industry, most of my friends either own or manage most of the bars in town. So it was a great fit for me. I rolled into that, and I was in sales for about 5 years. As a matter of fact, I worked together a lot with Matt. He worked for one of our competitors, and we both did promotions and anything in between here in town. So if you ever went out to a bar and had a free cocktail or a free shirt or whatever, anything that we were giving away, chances are, we were involved in that. I got a break from sales to go into operations, where I headed up the point of sale operations for our Lenexa distribution center. Worked there for about 5 years, and then transferred over to the Lawrence distribution center, which is where we do all of our distributing for product throughout the state. And I've been over there for about the last 5 years. So on a day-to-day basis, what do I do? Everything that would happen inside the walls of working in a distributor, from logistics to getting the product in, to working with people like Brad at Free State. We do distribute their beer. We partner with them on a lot of different things. And so we're working on getting the product in the door. Also, anything that goes on internally as far as from an operations standpoint during the day, getting the shift ready for nighttime production. And at nighttime, obviously, we do all the loading of all of our trucks for all of the liquor stores, bars, and restaurants throughout the entire state of Kansas. One of the cool things about what we do is that we actually distribute to all areas of the state every single day of the week, Monday through Friday. So a lot of people think that it's pretty cool that out of one distribution center here in Lawrence, Kansas, that we can cover the entire state of Kansas. So if you go out and you buy some of the brands that we carry, Crown Royal, Jose Cuervo, Captain Morgan, things like that, they came from our distribution center here in Lawrence. In the way that the franchise laws work in the state of Kansas, we have the distribution rights for the brands that we carry. So we are the only ones that can distribute those brands to the liquor stores, bars, and restaurants. Other than that, I just kind of oversee all of the operations and do whatever I need to do to help support the sales team. And that's basically it.
Thank you all. Good job. Okay, so this is the part where we kind of want you guys to piggyback off of each other with some of the questions that we have. So Matt, since you've worked in so many different areas of beer, we'll start with you with this question. What makes working in beer different than other industries?
Lots of things, but I guess mainly most people who that I used to work with, the marketing directors and owners of breweries, I guess we'll start there. Most of those people used to do other things, like consciously left what they were doing to, follow something they're interested in. And that gives everybody kind of the drive and passion and creativity that you don't see in a lot of industries, I guess. Everybody, there's a collaboration and camaraderie between breweries and the country because everybody, at some point, took the leap to do this themselves. They left a lot of really successful people before they opened breweries, and they just quit to open breweries. Everybody feeds off each other, and it's kind of been this whole, rising tide lifts all boats kind of feel in the craft industry forever, and you can see it across the world. It's just a bunch of really rad, creative people doing what they love, and you don't see that.
Can I pick you up back again?
Yeah. I noticed when Trent said, I used to work with Ben.
Yeah.
We worked for rivals. Anyone else hear that?
Yeah.
That's some beer industry, though. They're like, oh, yeah, we used to work together. And I was thinking, oh, you work for the distributor? The different one.
Yeah.
That's not typical for a lot of industries, but it's true, even with breweries, too. I know a bunch of guys at Free State. If Free State guys walk in our bar, they can't pay for a beer. It's just the way it works. It's people you know, and those relationships matter. And you end up collaborating with other breweries, and you end up going to other breweries and shaking hands, and you don't talk bad about other people. It's just kind of, it's really a friendly place to work because it is a bunch of rad people. And if you meet someone who's not rad, no one else likes them either.
I think something that's important about that is, yeah, we're all in competition, but we all want the other brewery to make good beer. We want good beer across the board. We're not afraid to tell. If somebody comes into your brew house, what'd you do to make that? You're going to tell them everything you did in the process. It's not kept under lock and key. You want them to learn from you the tricks you did, because some of them are just like, oh, this happened, and it just worked out great. And somebody's going to go, I'm going to try that, and it's great, good, go try it. I'm not trying to keep that secret. And then just the, what I've learned, the 20 years about, you help each other. Right now, tomorrow morning, I'm sending a guy up to Blind Tiger, Topeka, because we're missing one bag of Munich 2 malt, which means nothing to you. It's just a type of malt, but we're short for a recipe. We have a truck coming in on Thursday. It got delayed for Wednesday. John Dean's going to give us a bag of malt. We're going to take one back. We've had to run up to Boulevard to get yeast. I know we'll be across town. We'll be helping. We've done with you.
Yeah. We've
gave us yeast to make a Kolsch.
You know, if you go to some of this, the
literally happens all the time.
I mean, the big boys out there, the Amish, they're not going to give you. I mean, that's under lock and key, the recipe, and that's fine. You know, they have their niche. They're doing great at what they do. I'm not going to discredit them on anything. They make a solid product every time. It tastes the same across the nation. You can't discredit that. But the craft industry, it's so friendly. It's been such a pleasure to work in for all these years. And all the festivals I've gone to, and just have everybody. And yeah, I mean, after a couple of beers, everybody becomes real good friends. it's been really nice to have that because, you know, I've done some other businesses where I helped set up a tree company, became an arborist, and we were out there bidding on trees, and nobody really wanted to talk about what the price was or what they were doing. I did carpentry and construction with all the bidding wars and stuff, and you didn't get together with your rival. And that's the other thing, get together. When we get done with work, not everybody just clocks out and runs. Pretty much stick around and have a beer with your friends, your coworkers, and that's something that I think is very unique to the industry, that a lot of people stick around after they clock out and maybe have a cold one and share, you know, talk about the day and then move on, and that's unique.
Festivals, like beer festivals, are always awesome for meeting, like, other
like
brewers. Yeah, and like a lot of times, I love when they do like a brewer event before the fest starts, and you really get to like talk to other brewers, and you get to learn about them and their brewery, how they started, and you get to learn a lot just from talking to people, and people love to help out, like we've been saying. So I just love that about this industry. It's just, it is like a, it's like a family or something, you know? They just...
Thanks, guys. So I'll go into the next question. Trent, we'll start with you since your background's a little bit different. So what skills in your background helped you get to this point in your career?
Oh, wow. You know, I got to say that it's really my relationships that I built in the industry that I was in. I got my job in the industry starting off working at a bar because of somebody that I knew. I got my first job with Standard Beverage because I kept in contact with a sales rep who used to call on me when I ran the bar. And every step along the way for me has always been a benefit from one of the relationships that I made somewhere along the way. And you continue to make those as my career grows. I always reach out and make as many connections as possible. You see a lot of, I guess I could say, rotation in industry, especially on the supplier side of things and the distributor side of things, where one guy that may work for us may end up going working for Sam Adams, or may end up going working for Free State or Boulevard, or we may have somebody that's worked for one of them come work for us. So it's always good to keep those lanes of communication open and meet as many people as you possibly can, and that's what's really helped me grow and be able to succeed in the different roles that I've been in. Up until this point.
So, Victoria, you are very new to your field. So, what skills do you think got you to your first, I guess, what I call my job is my first big kid job?
Yeah. Well, I actually started at 23rd Street Brewery as a host, and in hopes that I'd meet the brewers and maybe learn something, or, I didn't know if there'd even be a position or anything. But so I went in there, immediately started asking questions about how I could meet the brewers, how I could get up there, and I would go up there, and I had like 3 part-time jobs actually at the time. So in any free time I had, I tried to make it there on their brew days, and I was just taking notes, and I was trying to weasel my way in there, and then it turned out that a position was opening, and so like, I don't know, I went in there and I showed up time and time again to try and get that position, and it worked out. Also, my chemistry background helped me like get the position because there were other people going for the job that I have, but I think it helped with my chemistry background to be able to do some of those things. So, yeah, and my willingness to clean, well, again, willingness to work really hard and sweat a little bit.
So Kyle, you come from a teaching education background, so that's, how do your skills then get you into Tours and Rec at Boulevard? What do you use on a daily basis from that?
Well, obviously a lot of that, both with internal like training, but then also also just with presenting. When I went to my first interview at Boulevard, like the first question I was asked is, are you comfortable talking to 30 people at once? And I love that. It's literally what I do all day, every day. And she's like, good answer. And the second question was, are you comfortable talking about beer? And I answered, if I find myself in a social setting and other people don't want to talk about beer, I generally get uncomfortable. So that's how it started. So it was definitely like those skills that are already kind of there. Now, for me, I think there was also just like other passions, like cooking. Cooking is something that became really big for me. And when I first applied there, I hope this is Facebook Live appropriate. I guess it is. I started a supper club. It was like an underground supper club. So I would host these like 6-course beer dinners in weird places and garages in the West Bottoms. So we called it Food Underground Kansas City, which looks F-U-K-C, which is a beautiful logo. So I was doing stuff like that, and I started doing these recipes online. And so one of the first ones I did, I actually contacted the people at Boulevard because I needed help and samples. We have an amazing beer called Bourbon Barrel Quad. I'm biased, but I'm not wrong. It's an amazing beer. So it's our Belgian quad, and we age it in bourbon barrels, and then we add cherries to it. So we call it BBQ. So I wanted to do a BBQ recipe. So I took a steak, and I soaked it overnight in bourbon and sugar. So there's your first ingredient. And this is this old recipe I discovered. So you put it on the grill like that, and then the whiskey ignites. So the whole steak lights on fire, and all the meat fibers seize up, and they suck in the sugar and the whiskey. So you leave it pretty rare. And then I made like a bacon cherry 6-glass sauce, and like drizzled it over the steak. And so I'd been in contact with these people, and I'd be taking pictures, and it was delicious, I knew that, and I knew this was a great recipe. My wife takes great pictures, so then suddenly somebody at Boulevard knew I was this guy on the other side of town who was really passionate about using their beer and cooking with it. So then when I got into a job there officially, and then they needed someone to create the kitchen, I was honored that they decided to let me do that and not go out. You know, we're a big enough company that you might ask a big local chef to do something like that. But I was approached before them, and they said, because I understand the beer and I've been doing it for a while. So it was a skill that I had, but I gained it. Like, I did it because it was something I loved. And like you said, you just were passionate about it. Like, I'm not saying I would have cooked that steak when I was in college. But 5 to 10 years later, when I kind of kept doing this, and I have the journalism degree, so I was writing and cooking, and finding a way to get paid for that, then it was this additional skill I had that was super valuable to the brewery. It really helped me kind of get that full foot in the door.
So, Brad, you have been working, how long have you been working in the beer industry? About 20 years?
Yeah,
18. Okay, 18 years.
4 years off for some other stuff.
So as long as some people in the audience have been alive, probably.
I started.
No, well, I have a question here. So how has the field changed over time since you've started?
How has the field changed? Just kind of saturation. You go to the liquor store right now and just go in for an IPA and you can spend 30 minutes staring. And I don't think that's a bad thing. It's overwhelming sometimes how many breweries there are. I think I looked tonight. When I started in 99, there was somewhere around 1,500 breweries in the United States. And there's, last year there was 5,700. I have it written in my pocket, I'm not going to look, but quite a large number of difference there. So when I first went to the Great American Beer Festival in 2000 out in Denver, which is kind of the biggest beer fest of the year in the United States, it was big. You know, there was probably 25,000 people attended it over the full weekend, and now they're pushing 60,000. It's huge. You can't taste all the beers. It's overwhelming. It's super fun, especially when you're in your 20s and just have fun like that. But there's been a lot of changes with the palates of the American people as well. You know, when I started, and I actually started Free State in 96. I started as a disher and a busser. It just kind of moved up. I became in the kitchen, and I had bar back, and I bartended, and I managed the brood. So I run the gamut in the restaurant world too. But our Copperhead Pale Ale, for instance, was about as hoppy as it came in the late 90s. I mean, it just seemed so hoppy. Now, that's just not what people, I mean, to been a trend towards the IPAs recently. I don't think there has been. Right now, we're on a sour trend, it seems like, across the board. People are having lots of fun with bugs and different fruits out there, and that's kind of new to us. I shouldn't say new, but it's broadening into the horizons out there.
Now you're allowed to explore.
Yeah, it's having more fun. Everybody was real, real nervous about it. I wasn't the creative guy. I was told to do something, and I made sure I did it the best of my ability, and I scrub. So my brewmaster was the one doing the recipes and having fun, but now that's a big difference. The recipes are, they're all over the place. I looked this up too. I think there was about 60 categories of beer when I went to the first GABF, and I think it's pushing 100 right now, if not. I mean, these are all just different categories you can enter in competition, and it's kind of off the charts of different stuff out there. So that's a big change. Just a lot of different beers out there anymore. You know, there's still classics that are going to hold through. I mean, you know, we still produce brown ales every year. People want them. They may not sell as fast as a great IPA that has citrus notes, but there's still the people out there that want that. You got to appease those masses too, because not everybody wants to go on IPA anymore, and there's always going to be stout drinkers.
Trent, how does that work with your distribution as things have changed over time and people have different tastes?
Yeah, so it's tough, right? Because we want to be, from a distributor, we want to be the best. We want the brands. We want every brand that's out there. Well, we go after them pretty heavily. We don't always get them. And, the hard part is if you go out to a bar or a restaurant, you go and you're seeing a lot more craft beers on tap now. You're not seeing as many Bud Light, Miller Light, Coors Light. You're seeing a lot more craft stuff, especially in Lawrence. And hopefully with Matt and his team, and they're going to start producing some stuff you'll see out at the bars as well. One of the issues that I think that kind of streamlines down to our customers is if you got a bar and you've only got 10 draft handles you can put on tap, which 10 are you going to put on? Right, and so we're fighting to get all of ours on there. We want the business, but we also have commitments to our suppliers. Right, they went with us for a reason, because we're the biggest, because we're the best. And on the flip side of that, some of them don't come to us because of that. They don't want to come to us because we're big. We have a lot of really big brands, and they feel like they're going to get lost in the shuffle, so to speak. If they figure if they can go to a smaller distributor, they're going to get a little bit more attention, a little bit more love from those smaller people. They have less brands to push. So that kind of is what I see out in the market, where you've got a choice in what are you supposed to do. You know, Walmart has a lot of really good beers. Lawrence Beer Company has a lot of really good beers. Free State, we distribute them. They have a lot of really good beers. How do we take care of all those obligations to them, where they're all profitable? And that's a challenge for us. We're always looking for ways to try to get past that, but it's a reality, and you're starting to see. So this kind of ties into just the sheer number of different types of beers that are out there. You're always seeing a change, and what's hot 1 minute, 2 weeks from now might not be hot. And what we purchase, we're not really purchasing 5 kegs, 10 kegs. We're purchasing by the pallet, and when we bring in a half of a truckload of beer from somebody with the expectation that it's going to sell, what happens when all of a sudden, after a month, it becomes yesterday's news and nobody wants to drink anymore? So the skew proliferation, as we like to call it, is probably the biggest challenge for us on how do we, how do we distribute all of it when we can.
Yeah, I'll piggyback on that. As a brand new brewery opening up in this world, Brad talked about saturation and the demand for tap handles and shelf space. It's crazy. I mean, there's people spending, I come from the marketing branding world. I worked with breweries who opened up, and then 3 years later, they had to spend, $50,000 and completely rebrand because they weren't getting the shelf space. Their beer's great, but, you walk in a cooler, and it's a visual now. It's people want
way that, you know, like Sierra Nevada in this market, it's awesome beer, but their sales aren't growing anymore because there's so many other options, which is great for the beer drinker in general. It's just the whole kind of business plan is shifting to more like hyperlocal, and that allows you, Sierra Nevada, to be profitable. They have to make a ton of pillow, which is great. But if those sales slow down a little bit, then they really feel it. You know, if we have beer, or if Free State has beer, that doesn't sell very well, we don't really dig it, cool, we'll make something else. And we didn't send out a million cases to the country. So, in my opinion, even the 6 years that I've been marketing branding work, I've really seen that. People really paying attention to beer. You know, they're branding.
With Lawrence, the local is getting exciting because, you know, when I started, I cannot remember 23rd Street was there in 99, but we had a place called Brown Bear right downtown. It was in the 800 block. They were there for a little bit. It was a fun place that I could go to maybe a little early in my life. But I worked at the other brewery. But I think the neighborhood, I mean, 23rd Street kind of fills a niche of kind of the west side of town. And I think with Yankee Tank that's coming in, that's brewing beer for Henry T's, that's another neighborhood spot where those people, because each of these bars and restaurants, they have their patrons. Not everybody that lives out west wants to fight going to find a parking spot downtown. Not everybody that lives on the east side really wants to go out west. So I think that's up 23rd Street out there, because, and there's a lot of apartments out there now and stuff. So you guys have, like Matt said, the neighborhood feel out there. And then now that you guys are kind of in a nice area of the regentrification of the arts area down there with all the galleries and stuff, so it's a pretty hip spot.
Yeah, I feel like, you know, every brewery kind of has their, like, regulars that are always coming there, and then you also have a lot of people that just want to go to breweries anywhere that they go, so, like, people traveling, like, you know, anytime I go somewhere, I always Google, like, breweries, and a lot of people do that now, and, like, go brewery hopping and stuff, so, like, having multiple breweries in a town isn't necessarily a bad thing, because people will still go to them, you know, and that's another thing why we're like in competition, but not really, because people love beer, and we love beer, and people will drink it. They're going to make different things than we're making, and, you know, it's a good way to try all different kinds of things, and people are going to travel.
Like, more good beer in Lawrence, the better, however it is, be it, in, you know, just coming up and putting Lawrence on the map is a good beer destination. It's awesome for everybody in this town. It's going to be good for food, for clothes shopping, anything, anywhere you go, because we have all kinds of events that, you know, even if it's a dad taking their kids out to Rock Chalk for soccer, well, let's go out to eat tonight. Well, let's go to a place where I can get a good beer, you know. Even if it's a restaurant that isn't a brewery, but they're serving local beers, people trend to that, I think, in this day and age. Not everybody, but it's, and, you know, that's where, you know, Standard's pushing all of our products wherever.
That, you're absolutely right, though. It is tough. I've got friends that own restaurants, and especially when I was on the sales side of things, and I was going and I would push, for instance, Free State. We launched Free State when I was a sales rep, and to go into somewhere that's downtown and maybe in competition with them on the restaurant side of things, it was a very hard sell to sell in. Why do I want to bring this beer in? You know, are they going to serve my chicken wings across the street? Or are they going to serve my hamburgers over there? It's a battle, but what they need to realize is that, like you said, there are people who maybe want to go drink the beer, but maybe they don't want to go eat at Free State. Or, you know, same thing with 23rd Street Brewery. We used to distribute their beer for a long time. And it does happen, and that's the kind of, that's the cool thing, is to see these beers getting out and getting in other places, because then, you know, you can kind of go to where you're comfortable, and you can still drink the good beers that they're producing. So,
so I come from kind of the exact opposite of everything you guys are talking about, kind of, because John McDonald started the Boulevard Brewing Company in 1989. You're talking about IPAs, and he tells stories of people spitting pale ale out because it was too soapy. And it's 30 IBUs. It's like one of our lower hopped peers now. So that's changed. But for us, you know, our president says something sometimes, that when we opened, we were the hometown beer of Lincoln, Nebraska. And that's what, there was no place closer. If you lived in Lincoln, the local beer was Boulevard Wheat. That's not true. We're not even a local bar, local brewery of the crossroads anymore. You've got Torn Label. You've got Double Shift. There's a ton of them down there now. So for us, the space that I helped open has kind of opened us up for that. You know, we saw, I think, 80,000 tourists last year. And I would argue that's really, really good for Torn Label and for Double Shift and for hotels and for restaurants. And I said I created the kitchen, and that's true. We were very conscientious as a company. We do like pretzel dogs, meat and cheese boards, a really good onion dip, stuff like that. But we're not doing tacos on Southwest Boulevard because we want you to go to the taco joints that bought our beer in 1989 and buy more of our beer there. Because it's communal. And people supported us, and we want to support them. That doesn't mean we don't want to draw people in and have that opportunity to tell them how cool we are. But we also want to support everybody around us. So it's weird. We didn't have this kind of neighborhood vibe for 20-something years, but there's so much value to it, and there's a lot of numbers that back that up, that it really works for your company. And it is. I'm like all these people. Everywhere I go to different breweries. I drink other people's beer. So when we have people in Kansas City, we want them to come to Boulevard first, and we want them to drink our beer. But I love talking about the other breweries around town. We get people that say they're coming to Warren, so I'll always tell people to go to Free State. When people are in town, they might not just be in Kansas City. We are kind of one big neighborhood.
So that makes me think, Kyle, about the future of employment in the industry, because we're seeing a lot of expansion in tourism rec money. So Boulevard has their nice kind of mini museum in there and tours that they do every hour on the hour, right? Every day of the week.
Yeah, we give out about 720 free tour tickets just on a Saturday.
Right, so we see that. We see changing taste, and we see kind of the expansion of the brew industry. So what does the future employment in the industry look like, do you think? We can start with you, Kyle.
I don't know. I think we've talked about this. It's true. So I don't know who said it. I think it might have been you, Brad, that there's a lot more breweries today than when you started. I started it in 2012. When I was given tours, one of the things we would talk about is 1880, there was 4,500 breweries. After Prohibition, there was 500. By the year 1980, there was like 46 breweries in this country. That's mind-blowing, because now we're at 5,000-something. So in 1980, this was incredibly streamlined, and there was only 46 breweries in this country, and now we have well over 5,000. So I do think there's a question of, are we going to have 10,000 breweries in 3 years? Maybe. If we are, they're going to have to be like the Lawrence Beer. They have to be smaller. I'm doing my part to keep up with America drinking enough beer to support 10,000 breweries. But whatever we do, there is a question of, are we going to reach that kind of apex? But that being said, Victoria said this earlier, people love beer. There's jobs there. I know they would say, like, in a recession, people buy more beer when they have less money. I know that's what I did in college. It's true. So there's jobs there, and I do think they're shifting a little bit. This is a cool panel because we all have come from very different sections of what happens in the beer industry, but all of these sections have jobs. And I definitely agree with what Trent said, I think it was Trent, that there's a lot of people that switch teams a lot. On our sales force, like I said, I do sales training, that people that have been other salesmen or worked at other breweries, everybody has that experience. So it's kind of like get in the door and then figure out where you want to go, because there's going to be an opportunity to go left or go right or stay on the path you're on, as long as you just kind of keep trudging along. But I have no expert sage advice about where the market's going.
Well, and you know, there's a surprising number of different, you know, obviously at a brewery, you know, the size of Walmart, or, you know, I used to work with a brewery in Minneapolis called Surly, when they opened up a brand new, like, $30 million beer hall. Beautiful. The guy who I worked with who did the retail was head of retail for Pacific Sun before that. And then so he came in, they realized the benefit of a retail program, and he brought somebody in, and he shaped this huge, you know, they had a 3,000 square foot retail store in the group, you know, and he has since left, and now he's head of retail for Quicksilver, which is awesome, because I mean, half price off. But it's like, you know, certainly they have, you know, they have graphic design team on house, they have accountants, there's like five accountants, and they have, you know, people like these guys that are making sure of the 24 hours a day trucks are organized and going out to all these different states, and like, you know, there's front house people, there's kitchen, all these new breweries are So it's just, you see all these people, and you know, it's not even mentioned about like the amount of organic chemistry degrees and things that are out there. Like it's good. There's some really smart, creative, awesome people out there, and everybody just assumes that we just hang out and drink beer all day. It's just like 60% accurate. There's some really smart people out there, and so you can really, you know, whatever you are interested in, if you're also interested in beer or a growing industry or anything creative, they're not mutually exclusive.
A lot more going on. I have a degree in geology. I've gotten good at working on machines, but since the second bottle line, we've hired a mechanic that's on staff all the time. He does anything from gearboxes to motors. He does some of our welding. I know you guys have some brilliant welders at your place that do the sanitary welders. Steve Tucker, for instance, I know him. He does. So they got the boulevards because they keep expanding. You have welders that mechanics. I pay the taxes. I have to pay excise taxes twice a month. I never thought I would be counting to do taxes for excise tax on alcohol, but I do. So there's a lot going on there. But I got my start in a dish bowl, and I can't stress, that nobody wants to bust suds. But I did it the best I could. I started sirloin stockade. Up to the baker there and started working at Free State at the same time as a busser disher, and I got behind the bar within about 2 years, just for busting my tail. I didn't want to dish till 2 a.m., but I did it. I did it the best I can, and at this point, I feel like I've rose with this company. I've grown. They've started in '89, I started in '96. I'm still with them. So there's lots of jobs. I've learned a lot with what I do, so it's good stuff. I think going to the how many jobs are out there, I feel like there is a trend. Back when you're saying the 1800s, how there was 3,000 breweries, they couldn't move beer across the nation like they do now. There, there wasn't the rail system, there wasn't all the LTL, there wasn't refrigerated trucks. So there was regional or local breweries. We had a Bauerstock. I think it was the Bauerstock Brewery. It was in North Lawrence. There's still caverns over there where they used to sell their stuff. So that was the local brewery here. And I feel like it's kind of that trend back. So you are going to have this more of the smaller breweries in each town, not dependent on the big, huge domestics that are pushing it by the train load across the nation. So, which in turn creates jobs for all the little places, be it if you're a host to start and move up, or a disher that moves up to a brewer. We have a bookkeeper. There's all kinds of stuff. We have carpenters that come in, plumbers. There's always stuff to do with it. But the restaurant industry is the path for lots of breweries, which always has jobs, especially for college people. Like maybe like me, I like being outside in geology, but I needed a job at the time, and it just kind of worked its way in where, I had my resumes out. Well, brewer equipment, are you interested in that? That sounds pretty cool, and I love the beer. I just never thought, I didn't start working at the brewery specifically to become a brewer. It just kind of happened. It's just, I was talking to people, kept talking within the industry, going to other breweries, and then a position opened up, and I hopped on it. It was the low totem right then. I was at the bottom of the ladder, and I was scrubbing the trenches, which literally the trenches in the brew houses that you dump the yeast down. But I think there's going to be those jobs for a while. I hope, it kind of keeps going. It is hard to keep my product out there, being selling it. I want my product to keep selling upward path. But if it's flat because everybody's flat, that is a saturation, which I hope doesn't. I hope it changes, but there is jobs out there.
Thank you. Okay, we have one more question, and we'll go down the line starting with you, Trent, on this one. So in your job specifically, so each of you come from a very different background, what advice would you give some of the students in the audience who are interested in what you do?
I would say start laying the foundation of making those connections, in the parts of the industries that you want to get involved in. If you want to become a brewer, got some good connections here to reach out to and ask questions and learn. It really depends on what you want to do. From my standpoint, from an operations background, so to speak, we have, there's so many different things you can get into, and this kind of ties back, to the last question of, you know, job opportunities. But there's a lot of different things. You know, we've got an accounting team, we have a legal team, we have a graphics design team, we do all of our own in-house graphics. You know, we've got salespeople, we've got drivers, we've got warehouse workers, we've got people that are mechanics that work on our vehicles, they work on our conveyor system. So a lot of different things. But you know, even if you're not sure, you know, maybe you know that you want to somehow be involved in the industry, but you don't know exactly what it is that you want to do. Make those connections. Go visit places to go see what they do. You're more than welcome to come in and see anytime what we do at my facility. And I'm sure everybody up here would welcome you in to come in and take a look at what they're actually doing. And that's the best way to get a feel for it. You know, you may come in and think that you want to be a brewer. You may see what it actually tastes, because it's a lot of work. And you may say, you know what, not for me. But for what I do, you know, if you would have told me, you know, 12 years ago, 15 years ago, that I would have been a VP of operations for a liquor distribution company, I would laugh at you. And I was out partying in the bars all the time, and that's what I thought I was going to do. I thought I was going to own a bar. And, you know, my path has led me to where I'm at, and it's been great. I've learned a lot of things along the way. But again, it all stems from those relationships that I've built with the people over the years of being in the industry. Is this the final stop for me? Probably not. I hope not. You know, there's bigger and better things to do, and I don't know what that's gonna be, but it's gonna be something in the industry, and it's probably gonna come by way of somebody that I know. So I guess that's what I would say is I encourage you to get out, you know, meet as many people as you can, ask questions, go and visit people, see what they do. Internships, we do internships at our company, not a ton, but we do them. But that's an option. Get involved. Because there's a lot of different ways that you can get involved in the beer industry and not just be a bartender or a waitress, or, you know, if you want to be somebody that's, you know, I don't know what, sommelier or cicerone, if you want to be a cicerone. I guess I keep going back to the relationships, so I guess that's where I'll leave it as.
Brad, do you have anything to add or something specific to your job? Oh, you want the question again? What advice would you give to some of the students in the audience interested in what you do?
Well, like Trent said, I think, getting out there and seeing what's done. I mean, we all provide tour. I don't know if you guys do tours to the public. I've been on a tour there. It's not exactly, there's a lot moving through there. But tours, we bring people through. You may not ever, you know, today I threw cases of beer for about 4.5 hours. I probably threw 400 cases. That's not everybody's dream job, to build pallets of cases. I had to fill in. Have somebody go on vacation right now. But that has to be done in order to get beer out to the market. So that's where people start. It's not dreamy, but, you know, there's a guy coming around my corner to pick up a case of beer, and he goes off to the lab. He's got a microbiology degree. He's testing. He's plating up our beer. He's going out. He was taking samples, swabs off of the things on the tanks, our sample valves. You know, that's the type of thing you may not ever think about, like that a microbiologist is in there. You know, we employ him. We have a lab for him. And he's making sure that we have a clean product from point A to, you know, point D, if you will. So there's a lot going on in there. The more you tour, you'll see the more restaurants and breweries you go out there into the world. You're going to see all kinds of different models. I mean, say you just want to open your own restaurant that's a gastropub, just have a bunch of good beer. We'll start going to all those. Go down to Merchants. Go to Burger Stand. Go explore these places that have that concept. But really, if you want to do any of this, it doesn't matter what job you have. I just say whatever job you get, what position you start at, own it, do the best you can, and see where that takes you. Because I never thought I'd be sitting here at KU, you know, 20 years after I graduated from KU, talking about brewing. It's just my path and the way it did, the way it's happened. But every job I was ever tasked with, I tried to do it my best and really pushed hard to make it, do it right. And it's made me excel at what I'm doing. I've been promoted up through the ranks of my business because of that, I feel. So, that's my answer.
Yeah, I mean, you always, like you said, you always have your own ability to shape, you know, your role. And whatever you end up doing, whatever you want, like, if you want to do something within that company, like, you eventually will get that chance. You just have to be ready for it. You have to pay attention, you know, but like you said, go in these places. I wonder why they're selling this t-shirt. I wonder why they're using this glass. Like, ask them, find out. Like, because eventually you're gonna get an opportunity, you know, if you work the tail off and you're hanging out in the right places, which I think all of us just hung out in the right places, like, you're going to get a chance, you know, so you just got to be ready and be excited about it and be willing to work at it. And you know, back to the jobs thing, we didn't even touch on all the auxiliary jobs to support the big industry, you know, like people who make the labels for kegs, people who make the t-shirts, people who drive the trucks. You know. There's so many companies out there that aren't a brewery or a restaurant. They work only with breweries and restaurants. There's a whole other, you know, like, the last company I worked with before this had, was basically a design firm. There was like 25 designers and a staff of 35 total, you know. And they worked with breweries around the country just designing merchandise and branding. That's all they work with. So that designer got to sit around and help design, you know, Avery's tap room and all the merchandise. That's a cool job. They don't work with brewery, they don't have any brewery background, they're just an awesome designer. So again, just whatever you want to do, just do it, you know, work really hard at it and just find, you know, like you'll have the ability to work with whatever industry you see.
Say, you know, like if you want to be in the industry, you know, get started wherever you can. Like I started as a host literally last August and now I'm a brewer because I came in and I worked hard at what I was doing, you know, like, and I worked hard as a host and then I pestered them to get into the brewery and it all paid off in the end, and now I'm doing something that I really like and I plan on continuing to be a brewer and keep moving up and eventually I want to own a brewery too, actually, you know, and so it's just like start wherever and work hard and don't be afraid to have to scrub stuff.
Well,
I'm coming back to that every time, 90%, I swear.
Quick story about our brewer, Sam. He started making beer in college because too young to buy it and too young to buy it and too poor to buy it, I guess. But then he finally got a job cleaning and stocking things at a brewery called Half Acre in Chicago. And he just, whenever somebody was doing something, would go like find out what they're doing. And, okay, why are you doing this? And learn. And then eventually, somebody didn't show up. And like, well, we need somebody to run our filtration. And Sam's like, well, I've been watching this guy do it for 5 years. Like, I can do it. Let me check. And then he did it. And then all of a sudden, he just was like, brewer training. Knocking out things and just learning. You know, he just was interested in it, paid attention to it, and just, it was a chance, he just did it.
Yeah, kind of similar thing happened to me too, where the head brewer at the time was on vacation, and so I'd been coming out there a lot, and so then it was just, Tucker was the only one, and so I kind of went back to the mill, where we mill in the grain, and Tucker went to go check on the mash, which is where we make sugar water, essentially, for the beer. And so I just started picking up the bags and started milling in. I was like, see, look, I can pick up this 55-pound bags. Like, I can do this. I can, you know, I can do this job. And then I found out about the position. I was like, so what are the chances that I could be considered for the opening position, you know? So you just kind of weasel your way in there and learn as much as you can from the people around.
Sam was a brewer.
Yeah.
Over.
Yeah.
Good dude.
Yeah.
At the risk of being redundant, there's a guy named John Bryant, who is a legendary figure at Boulevard. He kind of created our smokestack line of beers. He actually just passed away, which was sad for everybody at our company. I had a night of drinking with him until late when we merged with Firestone Walker, because he actually had started working for them at this point. It was kind of his return home. And he told me the story of how he got hired. And it's weird, because up until then, I'd always thought of him as this like huge legend of Boulevard. And he showed up for a job interview for like a truck driver, and he didn't get hired. So he showed up for a job interview to do whatever, and he didn't get hired. And he ends up with like his fifth job interview, and John McDonald's sitting across the desk, and he's like, what the hell do I gotta do to get ready? I don't understand. And John said, you're not going to. Like, I believe in this. And you're talking in 1991, there's not a lot of craft breweries, and there's not a lot of money at Boulevard Brewing Company at that time. There's, you know it, like, this might not work. There's a lot of debt, and there's a lot of risk that's been taken, and things look okay early on, but that is a time where it's shaky. And John sat across the table and said, I'm in, man. Give me a job, and I'm here. And he did what these people have been saying. And he slowly, over time, I mean, he went to war with our sales department. This is insane. Saying, we shouldn't just sell Boulevard Wheat. We should make a beer like Tank 7. And the sales guy said, nonsense. Wheat keeps the lights on. You're wrong. And he had been there at that point for long enough to be passionate and to say, I helped build this company. I drove trucks for 6 years. I pay attention. I think I know what's important. And he became this legend, this guy that couldn't get a job pushing through for 5 interviews. But I think that speaks to what all these people here are saying, that if you can't be denied, you won't be denied. And you kind of get to make that choice on some level, especially today. Because if John McConnell doesn't want to hire at Boulevard, I think we've proven there's 5,600 other breweries where you might be able to get a job at. So today, if you really want in this industry, there's a chance. It's out there. Go get it.
Well, on that note, thank you all so much. Can we give our panelists a round of applause? Opportunities to come and see their work. Feel free to go and do that at this time, and please eat some more food. Thank you.